Okay, good morning to you. We have been discussing about ship resistance, and ship resistance we have seen the calm water resistance, that the ship is moving in calm water. Why calm water is considered that, even though you know, often the ship may not be operating in calm water, in sea it is going to operate in a wave condition. And a ship operating in calm water conditions is very rare, unless it get into a harbor region or maybe in sheltered waterways or maybe in inland waterways where the waves are not present. And also we considered in the previous class the resistance without the wind condition. This environmental effects have been not considered in the cases. And another reason for that being, model tests are performed in towing tanks where the water is still, and you are estimating the model resistance from the in that condition, that is the calm water condition. Then you extrapolate it to the prototype actual ship, and then you add the other environmental effects such as the increase in resistance due to waves and wind and other effects. So that is what we are discussing it here. You can see that the seaway effects on resistance. So in a real sea condition, what would be the additional effects coming to the, or additional effects coming to the resistance of the ship due to the environmental effect. So one of the aspects we have here we consider is the wind. We have already discussed about air resistance for ship, air resistance which it's pertaining to the resistance offered to the motion of the ship, where you consider still air. So when the ship is moving forward, there is a flow of the same speed of air in the opposite direction. So that is the air resistance. But in the case of a ship operating in open sea, an open atmosphere, there will be a wind, natural wind acting against the ship motion. So this wind is principally treated as the air resistance. Air resistance is along the longitudinal direction of the ship, whereas wind can come from any direction. So the component of the wind which opposes the motion of the ship will be treated as the wind resistance. Often these two components are clubbed together because principally they are same, air resistance and wind resistance are. So depending on the sea condition and weather condition, the air resistance or the wind resistance changes. So you have to have an idea about the direction of wind, velocity of wind to consider to estimate the wind force opposing the motion of the resistance, which you call as a wind resistance. Often you know, either wind strictly speaking is not a steady speed. If you take a record, time record of the wind, it is going to be unsteady one. It is not having a uniform velocity throughout, but often we treat the wind as having uniform velocity. So the wind resistance become predominant or become considerable when you consider a fast ship. When the I'm just telling about the air resistance, the fast ship we discussed last class, that air resistance depends on the wind ship speed, but wind resistance depends on obviously on the direction, as I said before, and also the velocity of the wind. The next aspect is a ship motion. If you consider the ship motion, that is, you know, which is not considered in calm water resistance estimation, the ship which is now exposed to a sea environment will be subject to motion, you know, the all the 6 degrees of motion. And the motion will generate waves. You just consider still water. Your ship is floating, and now the ship is subject to any motion. You just push it down. It's a heave motion, pure heave motion. You push it down. You see that waves are generated. It's not having speed. It's stationary. The ship is subject to heave motion. So as we discussed in the previous class, these waves possess energy. We have already discussed that, and that's a loss of energy to the ship system. So the ship, which is prone to all the 6 degrees of motion, will generate waves from each component or each mode of motion, and the resultant effect, you see a resultant wave, there will be a formation of wave which possesses energy and loss of energy to the ship, and hence adding to the resistance of the ship. Your ship is moving forward and subject to motion will have this effect. And the motion effect, obviously it depends on the roughness of the sea. If the sea is rough, naturally the motion will be more, and thus the size of the wave generated by the ship motion will be more. And when the size of the wave increases, the energy associated with the wave also increases. Energy is proportional to square of wave amplitude. So size increases, the energy also increases. So that means the resistance part coming from the ship motion also increases. So the ship experiences more resistance in a sea wave compared to still water. So there are two options in this case. So when the resistance increases, what happens? The speed comes down voluntarily, involuntarily. So automatically the speed comes down because the resistance has gone up. If you want to maintain the same speed in the same sea state in a rough sea condition, then you have to have a vessel which is powered to overcome the resistance, powered and with should have a propulsion system which generates a required thrust to attain the or to maintain the speed. So that is a ship motion effect. Then the next component is a wave reflection on the hull. You know that when the wave is progressing against the direction of the ship, it is blocking the propagation of the wave. So it is a hitting a boundary which get reflected back, part of the wave get reflected back. So which due to the change in momentum, there will be a opposing force to the direction of the ship. So this imparts another component of resistance. So this is usually felt in ships which are more full in form. Like if it is a tanker ship, the effect will be more, whereas for a container ship which is more fine, the effect will be less. So that is another aspect of the sea wave on resistance. The last component, that is a drift angle caused by wind, waves and rudder deflection. The ship in sea wave, due to the action of wind and waves, will change its direction. It may not be able for the ship to retain its straight direction. So it, because of the external disturbance caused by wind or wave, and also by the rudder, because you may put the rudder which will give a drift to the ship. So these are the effects which causes the drift to the ship, that is changing the direction, maybe slight change only. So this will increase the resistance of the ship. That is, instead of the ship moving in this direction with the drift, it will move in this way. So there is a substantial increase in resistance due to the drift angle. So these things are not considered when you perform a model test in a towing tank. So these are the additional effects on resistance occurring to a ship when it is put to operation in a sea wave condition. So that is what we discussed, it is a sea wave effects on resistance. Some other aspects we considered, which should be considered in resistance are this one, that is D'Alembert's. We'll just discuss what are the effects of this D'Alembert's paradox. We'll see maybe in the next slide what does it that means. Here the major components of resistance generally you consider the frictional resistance due to the viscous property of fluid and the wave making resistance at the free surface due to the pressure disturbance. So when you consider the body is deeply submerged, will there be a wave making? No, there is no wave making. So for a deeply case of submarine, your submarine is operating, you don't see any waves at the surface of water. So when the body is deeply submerged, there is no wave formation. Now we consider the body is deeply submerged, the water is ideal, you say perfect fluid, that is no viscosity. So which no viscosity means no frictional resistance, no viscous pressure drag, nothing, and body is deeply submerged, wave making, wave breaking, nothing is present. So no resistance for a body which is submerged, deeply submerged in an ideal fluid. So the body will move without a force. So it is only a paradox which never exists and which is the one put forward by D'Alembert, which is called the D'Alembert paradox. So next is the boundary layer effect. Boundary layer effects, it differs from model to ship. We have already discussed the boundary layer effect when we discuss about the viscous pressure drag. Boundary layer formation is due to the viscous property of fluid, water, and when and also the boundary layer, you know, the thickness increases from the forward side of the ship towards the aft of the ship, the maximum thickness coming in the aft region, and when the thickness go beyond a limit, the flow breaks. So this boundary layer formation, the type of boundary layer, whether it's a laminar boundary layer or a turbulent boundary layer or a transition boundary layer, all depends on the Reynolds number. Reynolds number of the model and ship are different. We'll see later when we discuss about the model test how they are different, what's the problem, and how it's tackled. So the boundary layer effects, actually what you predict from model test cannot be extrapolated to the prototype actual ship case. Then we have to consider the ship form variation at bow, stern, midship. So the form of the ship, we know that it influences the flow pattern around it. The underwater surface area determines the resistance component. So this, the form matters, and you know that fast ships generally are fine in shape where the wave making resistance is reduced due to the fineness in the form of the ship. And next is the interference wave pattern, that is ship, if you consider again we will see in the next is it generates waves from different discontinuities in form, or maybe where from wherever there is an abrupt change in the form. So when basic reason for creation of wave is the pressure disturbance. So whenever there is an abrupt change in the form of the ship, there will be a sudden change in the flow and pressure, and whenever there is a sudden change in pressure or flow, a wave system is generated from that region. So when you consider an idealist form of the ship, we will see it later, it will generate waves from four points, from the bow, from the two shoulders, and from the stern. So these wave systems, when they interfere constructively, that is the resultant wave size increases, then the wave making resistance increases. So that's why often many ships you find that a bulbous bow is provided, a bulb ahead of the bow, in front of the bow. So which will generate a wave system. The bulb is designed in such a way to generate a wave system which will destructively interfere with the ship wave system, and thus bringing down the size of the wave and hence the wave making resistance. So we this is a consolidation of the the total resistance what we discussed. You can see that I think there is a mistake over here. Okay, here this is basically CT. Okay, and here you see the total resistance, non-dimensional resistance is given by R by half rho V squared S. V is the ship velocity, S is a weather surface, it is underwater surface of the ship, surface area. So here, and it is plotted against the Froude number. Froude number is, you know, that V by root G L. So where V is the ship speed and L is the ship length, G acceleration due to gravity. So it represents a non-dimensional ship speed. So if you look to that, you can see the resistance components what we discussed so far put in a diagram form. You can see the total resistance, this is this dotted line here that shows the total resistance from a model, and you can see that the components here are this line, the bottom line which shows here, which is the frictional resistance flat plate, frictional resistance of a flat plate. We see the why a flat plate is considered, we see it later. Here you consider, a flat plate which is being towed through a tank at the particular speed, then you measure the resistance of that plate, the surface area of that plate, that is two surfaces put together, it is equal to the wetter surface of the ship and the length also preferably to that of the model. So it is a model wetter surface area putting to the two sides of the plate, and length of the plate is equal to that of the model which is being towed at a submerged level, so that wave disturbance also is, and you measure the drag offered by the plate when it is moving at that velocity and from which the resistance is obtained for the plate. So the tests have been done by, you know, maybe century old results are available where people have done experiments with using the flat plate, and the flat plate resistance are put forward by using some empirical relations which has been obtained, results obtained from model test. So we see the reason why that is used here later when we discuss about the model test and extrapolation. Then we have the frictional resistance. Here this component, this line over here is called the frictional resistance. Frictional resistance depends on the flow velocity. We say that the order of the velocity based on which the frictional resistance depends later. So frictional velocity, the velocity that is here the plate is moving, you are considering a plate and comparing with the ship frictional resistance, but in actual case the ship is having a 3D form, plate is a 2D one. So when there is a 3D form, the flow velocity passing the sides of the model or ship due to its curvature attain a higher velocity. That velocity increase adds to the resistance of the frictional resistance, so which is not considered in the flat plate. So you get an extra term which generally says a form resistance, that is the form of the ship contributing to a additional resistance. That also we see later how that extra term is being estimated. Then you have, we have discussed the viscous pressure drag the last class, where we said the viscous pressure drag is due to the viscous property where boundary layer is formed, flow separation in the after region, and eddies are formed. These eddies results in reduction in pressure, and then the supporting force reduced, which amounts to increase in resistance due to the viscous property of the fluid. So all these three components, that is the flat plate one, this line which is a flat plate, and then you have this one coming from the foam, then this difference coming from the viscous pressure drag, all these are due to the viscous effect. So the total thing, you will just put it as from here to here, this is the total viscous resistance. So the total viscous resistance got three components now. One is the flat plate resistance, foam resistance, and viscous pressure drag, all due to the viscous effect. When you consider the total resistance here, what is shown here, we have, that is, you can see this arrow here, so which represents the total resistance, okay, that got another small component also, the breaking resistance. We see here this resistance, the dotted line, which shows that the total resistance without the wave breaking, that is from here to here is the total resistance, that is from the baseline. So minus the flat plate resistance, which you get some empirical relation, that is called the residual resistance. The total resistance measured from a model minus the frictional resistance of the equivalent plate, that is a plate. So that difference is called a residuary resistance. So of the residuary resistance, if you look, you can see that one of the major component coming here is the pressure resistance. Pressure resistance we have already discussed. Pressure resistance may be due to wave making. You can see that pressure resistance again divided into, this pressure resistance is divided into here wave pattern resistance, that is the wave making resistance. We have already discussed about the, okay, so it is a pressure resistance here, which is another component. It is only a, you know, classification, viscous pressure drag also used in that along with the wave resistance. So it is a pressure resistance. Then you, we have additionally, we discussed about the wave breaking resistance. Wave breaking resistance, we have said when ship moves, the forend of the ship is having a stagnation point. At stagnation point, the pressure is maximum. The pressure is maximum, there it generates a wave crest. So bow part of the ship, it goes by the build up of wave. I just see maybe one or two slides, and I think I have put here you can see in this slide, see the is a model test which is being carried out here in the institute. You can see that the wave elevation at the bow part, here you can see the height is more compared to other region. So that is called the bow wave, the wave formed at this part. So when this wave go beyond the height, the wave won't be able to retain its form. That is, when the steepness go beyond the limit, the wave breaks. When the wave breaks, there will be more water particle kinematics because of breaking wave. So these water particle kinematics now associated with kinetic energy is a loss of energy to the ship system, which amounts to increase in resistance of the ship, and thus is termed as the wave breaking resistance. So if you can bring down the height of the wave and thus avoiding breaking of wave, you can save some part of energy or the resistance. Coming back to the previous slide, here you can see this is the wave breaking. So the physics you now know, because the building of wave at the bow region, and basic reason is that it is a stagnation point where the pressure is high and water level builds up. Then the spray resistance, which also we discussed, that is usually present in faster ships like planing crafts and all that. Due to the spray formation, there will be again more water particle kinematics, and thus the energy losses will be more, which adds to the resistance. Next component is the air resistance, which we again we discussed. You consider still air, the ship is moving, So there is a flow of air across it which offers a resistance to the ship, to the portion above water. So that is the air resistance. Next component is the steering resistance, which also we discussed in the last class. Steering, that is whenever the ship is the direction of the ship is controlled by the application of rudder. And whenever you put a rudder, and also we have seen that even for a straight course, often for a single screw ship, due to the flow kinematic asymmetry about its center line, you may have to put a small angle for the rudder for the ship to get a straight course. So in such cases, when the rudder is put to a small angle, the resistance of the ship increases. So this increase in resistance due to the application of rudder is termed as the steering resistance. So all these components, all these things we have discussed in the previous class also. So all these things put together, you get the total resistance. So normally from these resistance, air resistance, prayer resistance, steering resistance, etc., are not estimated from the model test. So that is why you have the total resistance is somewhere below, and other things are given additional to that. So in addition to this, all this, we have the effects of due to CVA, as we discussed before, due to wind action, due to the ship motion, there will be increase in resistance, and also we said due to the environmental effect, there will be a drift, there will be an effect. So we discussed very other components which adds to that. So the CVA effects on resistance are estimated depending on the route of operation of the ship. The sea condition varies over the period of the year, and also it varies from region to region over the globe. So whenever a ship is designed, one should have, or the designer should have an idea where the ship is going to put to operation. So if it's a, that means you will have a data of the sea state where the ship is expected to operate. And based on the sea state, you will be able to estimate or determine the motion characteristics of the vessel, and from which you will be able to assess the resistance, additional resistance coming to the ship, and based on which you can find out what is the power requirement for the main engine, and subsequently what is a propeller to be designed, propulsion system to be designed for that condition. So the environmental data is also important, including the wind direction, wind velocity, everything is required to be known to your designer to make a proper design of the vessel. So this is a representation of a resistance coefficient. We see different cases when you consider the fluid. Here you consider perfect fluid, body moving at surface. So you consider perfect fluid means there is no viscosity and the body is at surface. So there is no frictional resistance, mainly the wave making component. So you can see that there is no friction, only the wave making component is present. You can see the vessel at surface. Now you consider perfect fluid, body moving at surface. I think there is a mistake here, it is not a perfect, it is a real fluid should be, because you have the frictional resistance coming here, you have the frictional resistance and also the wave making resistance. So this is a case with a real fluid, that is the viscous fluid. Now you consider here same thing, here is a real fluid. Fluid with viscosity certain, this is the correct one, and body deeply submerged. When the body is deeply submerged, there is no wave making, only frictional resistance in the case of deep submersibles or submarines. So here you have the friction line, this is a skin friction, and only the friction is there when its body is deeply submerged. But now you consider this case of a D'Alembert paradox. You say perfect fluid, body deeply submerged, no viscosity, body deeply submerged, so no resistance, isn't it? This is the case. This is the case for the D'Alembert paradox, that is perfect fluid, no viscosity and hence no frictional resistance, and now body is deeply submerged, no wave making, so no resistance. The ship which is in steady motion, or the submerged body which is in steady motion, will continue to keep the speed without a problem because there is no resistance offered to that. So if you look to the flow along the ship, the flow, the boundary layer around the ship, the nature of the boundary layer is determined by the local Reynolds number. You know that when the Reynolds number is low, the flow is laminar. When the Reynolds number is high, it is turbulent, and in between these two, a small region we call the transition region. So when you consider the ship moving through water, you can see the bow part, the bow region of the ship, the local Reynolds number is small, is not it? So that means the Reynolds number is given as given by the expression VL by nu. VL by nu is a Reynolds expression where V is the flow velocity, L is the characteristic length, dimension of the body, and nu is the kinematic viscosity of the fluid. So if you consider the bow part of the ship alone, the bow part is having a small length. So VL by nu, L is a small length, speed remains same if you can consider. Nu also remains same, so that means the local Reynolds number is less. So low Reynolds number naturally will have laminar flow. So the forward region of the ship, you see that the flow is laminar, there is no disturbance the forward side of the ship. So after that the local length increases, so the Reynolds number increases, the flow changes to transition region and then to turbulent region, and the boundary layer thickness increases when it goes towards the aft of the ship, stern part of the ship, and beyond the limit, as we discussed in the last class, the velocity gradient changes. So when the velocity gradient is zero, it shows the initiation of turbulence, and when it goes to negative, the flow separates, and you know, even that zero, it's a beginning of the flow separation, and the flow separates. When the flow separates, when the flow separates, eddies are formed. So you can see the flow breaks and eddies are formed here. So here that is the ray. You can see that the flow, that the coefficient of friction against length, you can see the this is the coefficient is high, then it comes to a transition region, and then this is a turbulent flow region. So this is how coefficient of friction changes. We see details about the coefficient of friction later, how it is going to have such a trend, the coefficient of friction coming down. So this just to give an idea, what is the flow around the vessel? The flow will be laminar in the forward small region, then enters the transition region, then it enters a turbulent region for the boundary layer, and finally the flow separates towards the aft side of the ship. That is the reason what we said, the viscous pressure drag is created. So this is a difference how you distinguish between laminar and turbulent flow, schematical representation of that. You know, laminar flow means go in layers, the flow go in layers, very orderly flow, go in layers, whereas when it comes to turbulent flow, so that is what you say, that laminar flow, they move you know, orderly, layer wise, you can say slide over one another in relative speed. So there will be a shearing effect, each layer will have a different speed, so that is why you have a velocity gradient, velocity of each layer is different. So that is a velocity variation which results in friction between layers, the friction between layers results in a shear force bitumen layers, and when it comes to the body surface and adjacent fluid layer, there is a shear force along the surface of the, which you call as a tangential force, tangential stress or tangential stress due to the viscous effect. When you integrate that tangential stress over the wetted surface, you get the total frictional force. So here this turbulent flow, it is more random in nature. The fluid particles, they are not in orderly form, they move randomly, the fluctuations are very random, and that is how the turbulent flow is observed or defined. Again, you see there are eddies are formed, and you see flow separates and eddies are formed. So that is a region where it is chaotic, and you get lot of random behavior for the fluid particle motion. If you look to the laminar and turbulent flows more, you see the laminar, and that depends on the flow pattern. Laminar or turbulent flow depends on the fluid velocity, because you know that Reynolds number is a factor, it is a number which gives an indication for the type of flow. If it is low, you have laminar, if it is high, then it is a turbulent, and as I said before, in between you have a transition region. So this velocity, so it depends on Reynolds number. If the velocity is high, Reynolds number is high, flow become turbulent. Same body, high velocity. The same ship, if it operates at low speed, the flow is more laminar. The same ship, if it operates at high speed, it become, the boundary layer become turbulent. Then that is why it says it depends on the flow velocity. Then it depends on the form. That is, if the form is very smooth, streamlined, then the boundary layer will be more laminar in nature or more orderly in nature. But if you say there is a sudden change in curvature of the body, then flow separates, the turbulent layer become, the boundary layer become turbulent. So that is a difference. So form is another parameter. Then size of the body, placed in the flow. Size of the body, you see that the here you have the length is representing the size of the body. So when you consider long body, then naturally the Reynolds number will be high for the same velocity and same fluid, and for such a body the boundary layer will be turbulent. That is what you have seen in the previous case also, when we discussed about the ship locally. The initial characteristic of the bow part is small length, so the size of that region is less, and you have low Reynolds number and then laminar flow. So when go towards aft, the length increases, Reynolds number increases, the flow changes to transition and then to turbulent region. Then it depends on the depth of the water, and also it depends on the depth of water and waterway restrictions. Whenever there is a depth of water, means the waterway becomes shallow, which also we discussed the previous class, some effect of the shallow water. When the water becomes shallow, there will be a constriction at the bottom, the flow attains higher velocity. The higher velocity results again to turbulence. And similarly, when you have a constriction, waterway restriction, the breadth is canal or river or anything, naturally you have you will have more constriction for the flow, and the velocity of flow further increases, and thus the Reynolds number increases, and the boundary layer becoming more turbulent. So these are the major parameters when you consider the laminar or turbulent flow. What type of flow, what are the parameters which determine whether the flow around the vessel is going to be laminar, turbulent or transition. That is, you have to look into what is the velocity of flow, you have to look into the form of the, if it is very streamlined, very form, or maybe it is abruptly changing the form, or because the thing will be different for container ship, a fast ship which is very fine in shape, and tanker ship which is more full in form. Then size of the body, length of the body in relation to the flow, that matters here, and waterway restrictions where you have a shallow water, or restrictions in the sideways, all these determine the type of flow, whether it is laminar or turbulent. As the velocity increases, the flow changes from laminar to turbulent, which you have already seen. When the velocity increases, Reynolds number increases. So Reynolds number, from a small value it increases to a higher value when the velocity increases. So the flow change from laminar to turbulent, and also there is a small transition period called transition region. The transition here for a ship, generally the transition region is Reynolds number in the order of 10^5 to 10^6. It is only a general guideline, it is not strictly for all type of vessels, because we have seen that many other parameters influence the type of flow as we discussed in the previous point. So any, if it is a Reynolds number is less than 10^5, you say the flow is generally laminar region. If the Reynolds number is more than 10^6, then you say it is a flow is turbulent. So between 10^5 and 10^6, it is going to be a transition region, which is basically a mix of laminar and turbulent, that is what we call the transition. So thus in ship model experiments, the flow over a large area of the model can be laminar as we discussed before, because we have seen that the forward side of the forward region, the local Reynolds number is less and flow is laminar. And in the towards the aft, the Reynolds number will become higher and flow become turbulent. So this, you say the model experiments. Okay, in case now it's a case of model experiment. The ship models, ship model is quite small. Maybe 200-meter ship is modeled as maybe 4 meter. So the ship model length, if you look to the Reynolds number of the model and ship, the Reynolds number of the ship is much higher, comes in the order of 10^8, 10^9, whereas the Reynolds number of the model is usually less than 10^5, around the laminar region. So whenever you perform a model test, one of the criteria to be met between the ship and model is the kinematical similarity. That is, the flow condition around the ship should be similar, not same, it should be similar in the case of a flow around the model. So that flow condition again depends on the Reynolds number. So if you are not able to match the Reynolds number between ship and model, the flow kinematics differs. So the flow kinematical similarity is not achievable between ship and model, because you will not have the same Reynolds number. The length is much small, velocity you will see that it is also going to be small, but whereas the nu is almost same. Why? The ship operates in water, only difference in sea water. Model is tested in water, it is in fresh water. So both cases it is water, kinematical kinematic viscosity remains almost same. So the denominator remains almost same. We see discuss more about this when we come to the model test and dimensional analysis and all that. So a similarity is difficult to be achieved from the kinematical aspect between a ship and model. So here you can see the boundary layer turbulence of a vessel. You see the forward side is very almost very smooth flow, and when it comes towards the away from the forward, you can see that it is become foamy. You always note that the foam region represents the turbulence in the flow. So the forward region, you can see the local length is small, the Reynolds number is less and the flow is laminar. So when it goes towards the aft, the length increases, Reynolds number increases, flow become turbulent. The turbulence is the one which gives that foam effect, because the flow separation and there is a random movement. So this gives a foam generation. So it is visible from the operating vessel itself how it differs from region of forward part to the aft part of the ship. And also you see that the boundary layer thickness, you can see that increases towards the aft. So and the flow separates. So this is the Reynolds number effect on the flow characteristics around a vessel. The same thing which we have observed before, you can see that in this diagram here in this diagram we have seen that this is a laminar flow region, that's forward region, you have laminar and then you have the turbulent flow region. So same thing is visible from the photograph itself, which occurs, it's a reality. So next, consider the ship generated waves. When the ship is moving forward, you must have also noticed that you consider still water, the ship is moving forward, you generate waves. And the wave pattern is very characteristic. You see there is a particular pattern of waves created. So it will have a wave which is diverging, then you have waves coming across it, transverse waves. These two type of is characteristic with any ship. The same thing you can consider that I don't know whether you have noticed that when you put a in a channel or river where you consider there is a uniform flow, and often you might have noticed that mainly in the irrigation canals they put a pole to measure the water depth. The pole may be just coming out of water from the bottom fixed. So you, if you notice a flow around that pole, you see that there is a pattern of wave generated. It is almost similar to that of a ship moving forward in still water. You see there is a pattern of wave resembling to the same as the previous. So here you have a wave system generated by the ship. You have a, see the waves are generated from here, this is that, so its waves go propagate. So these are the diverging waves or divergent waves which diverge out, and here you can see that these waves, another one in the transverse direction. So this is another schematic representation of that ship wave system. You can see the ship waves are generated, and these are the divergent waves which is coming out, and these waves which tangentially join and which get such a shape, convex shape here, this is called the transverse waves. And these wave systems are generated from different regions of the ship. You can see that it started from here, another system from here, another from here, another wave system from here. So usually the ship, when you idealize the form, you see that there are four wave systems created from the ship. One from the bow, one from this region usually you call as the forward shoulder, and this region is where you call as aft shoulder, actually it is somewhere here, and this is the stern wave. So four wave systems are generated, but what you see is only the resultant wave. You do not, it may be difficult, but the visibility, that is a divergent wave and transverse waves are visible even in the real operating condition. So you will be able to visualize the presence of divergent waves and transverse waves when a vessel operates. This we have already seen, discuss about the bow wave. Now we look to the speed and power requirement. See, you like to have less power and attain high speed, attain high speed with low power. That is your intention. How far it is achievable? You know that when the vessel is shipborne, the vessel is waterborne, density of water is much higher compared to that of air. So when it is waterborne, more part underwater, you get more resistance. Resistance we have seen is proportional, depends on the fluid density. So if you can evolve a technique where the vessel can be brought out of water means not completely, at least partially, so that the contact with water will be reduced and the resistance will become less. So you need to have some technique if you can generate where it can be pushed up. So here these are some of the types. Here you can see that the hydrofoil craft, what you see here, planing craft, all these two types, they have a system due to hydrodynamic lift, it is pushed up, sometimes in hydrofoils fully out of water, so that the resistance become less and with the same power it can achieve very high speed. So that's it's basically this diagram is a comparison of different vessels. What is the power requirement for unit displacement per ton? Okay, I think we'll continue in the next class with this power requirement and other aspects of resistance. That's